So far, we've focused on explaining the basics of how to virtualize efficiently the CPU, but let's now look at the other types of resources, looking at memory first. We will explain how memory virtualization can be achieved for the two basic virtualization approaches, whether it's based on full virtualization or requires guest modification. And we will talk about full virtualization first. For full virtualization, a key requirement is that the guest operating system continues to observe a contiguous linear physical address space that starts from physical address 0. This is what an operating system would see if it actually owned the physical memory and ran natively on physical hardware. To achieve this, we distinguish among three types of addresses: virtual addresses, or these are the ones that are used by the applications in the guest; physical addresses, these are the ones that the guest thinks are the addresses of the physical resource; and the machine addresses, these are the actual machine addresses, so the actual physical addresses on the underlying platform. The similar distinction of virtual versus physical versus machine will also apply to the page numbers and the page frame numbers. So given this, the guest operating system can continue to make mappings of virtual addresses to the physical addresses that it thinks it owns. And then underneath that, the hypervisor will then take these physical addresses that the guest believes are the real ones and map them to the real machine addresses. So in a sense, there are two page tables, one that's maintained by the guest operating system and another one that's maintained by the hypervisor. Now remember that at the hardware level, we have a number of mechanisms: the memory management unit, TLB, caching of the address translations, that these mechanisms help with the address translation process, make it much more efficient, and don't require us in software to repeatedly perform address translations and validations. Now, this option that we discussed so far will require that every single memory access goes through two separate translations. The first one, which will be done in software, and then the second one potentially can take advantage of hardware resources like TLB, because the hardware will understand only this page table. Clearly, this will be too expensive, since this will add overheads on every single memory reference. It will slow down the ability to run at near-native hardware speeds. The second option is for the hypervisor to maintain a shadow page table in which it actually looks at what are the virtual addresses that the guest has mapped to these physical addresses. And then in the shadow page table, it directly establishes a mapping between the virtual addresses that are used by the guest and the machine addresses that are used by the hypervisor, by the physical hardware. Then if the hardware MMU uses this page table, the guest operating system is allowed to execute natively using the applications will use virtual addresses, and these will directly be translated to the machine addresses that are used by the physical hardware. The hypervisor will clearly have to be responsible to maintain consistency between these two page tables, and it will have to employ mechanisms that, for instance, invalidate what is the currently valid page table, shadow page table, whenever there is a context switch, or to write protect the guest page table in order to keep track of new mappings that the guest operating system installs, and similar mechanisms. This write protection is necessary so that whenever the guest OS tries to install new virtual to physical address mapping in the page tables that are used by the guest, this will cause a trap to the hypervisor, and then the hypervisor will be able to pick up that virtual address and then associate the corresponding machine address and insert this mapping into the page table that is used by the hardware MMU. This can be done completely transparently to the guest operating system.